Welcome to Mayo Clinic Sleep Medicine Podcasts, a series for physicians, advanced practice providers, nurses, and other health practitioners treating sleep disorders or interested in learning about state-of-the-art advances in sleep medicine and sleep health. I'm your host, Dr. Michael Silber.
And I'm your co-host, Dr. Maitri Juna. We are both consultants at the Center for Sleep Medicine at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota.
Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Mike Silber, your host for the podcast this afternoon. Sleep medicine physicians see several types of central sleep apnea, and a common cause is treatment-emergent CSA following initiation of CPAP therapy. Is this harmful to patients? How should it be treated? My guest today is Dr. Timothy Morgenthaler, Professor of Medicine and a board-certified sleep specialist at Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. Tim, welcome. Let's first discuss the cause of the phenomenon. It's not, I think, to most people intuitively obvious why treating OSA should result in the apneas converting from obstructive to central ones. We also see the phenomenon in other forms of treatment of OSA, including oral appliances and, rarely done today, but tracheostomy. Do we understand the mechanism?
Well, thank you very much, Mike, first of all, for having me, and especially for asking me about one of my favorite topics. So thank you for that. No, I agree. It's not absolutely obvious why this occurs, and there are several theories. I think maybe one of the ones that I believe in the most is the unmasking of pre-existing central sleep apnea. You know, some patients may have an underlying central sleep apnea tendency that really only becomes apparent after an additional obstructive component is treated with PAP therapy or an oral appliance, as you say. And then with the reduction in airway obstruction, then you can see the central tendency that was previously masked. And I tend to think this is the most common mechanism. The control of breathing is just inherently less stable in some patients with increased responsiveness to minor fluctuations in breathing disturbances that then lead to repetitive over and under breathing events so that you really see this central sleep apnea pattern showing up. You know, there are tests, for example, that can pretty accurately predict the likelihood and which patients will show treatment emergent central sleep apnea before the OSA is treated. So I think this is one of the leading mechanisms, but there are some other theories that have some merit. Another one that I think is prevalent and often talked about is the effects of pressure alone. And I think this is in part because so many times treatment emergent central sleep apnea is seen as we apply CPAP. Many have expressed concern that the Herring-Broyer reflex plays a role. Of course, this reflex is primarily known for its role in preventing overinflation of the lungs. It's a feedback mechanism that's mediated by stretch receptors in the lungs that ultimately inhibits inspiration of the lungs when they're inflated up to a certain extent. And while it's primarily protective to prevent that lung overdistension, it does also have an influence on complex sleep apnea, as we initially called it, or treatment emergent central sleep apnea. But it's not, I think most people don't consider it a primary factor, but it certainly has secondary or contributory roles. It does contribute to the regulation of breathing patterns by modulating the duration of inspiration and expiration, and it can just throw the timing off. So in some patients, that reflex may play a bigger role than others, but I've been a bit skeptical about how much that mechanism contributes. For one thing, just by way of reasoning, if that was a big component, I think we would expect to see much more of a dose response to CPAP. And instead, what we generally see in the clinic is, as we begin a CPAP titration, we get up to a certain pressure where the obstructive events are all gone. And then, you know, even if we continue to go up, the central events continue to occur at more or less the same frequency. So it doesn't seem to me likely that that usually plays a role. There's a few other mechanisms, but it looks like you have another question for me.
Well, so when I explain simplistically to patients, well, the brain gets confused about all this high pressure of air getting into the lungs, which it never has before, and says, what's all this high pressure doing there? Too much breathing. Stop. I'm not too far off, am I?
Well, no, I think, I mean, I think that can contribute, but at least the way I tend to explain it to patients is, gee, you know, we know from international studies that between 5 and 10% of patients experience this, and it's probably really more in their innate control of breathing. And once we sort of unmask the tendency by getting rid of their concurrent obstruction, then here we go. We see their central sleep apnea. And you know, there are some other mechanisms that have been postulated. You know, CPAP therapy can reduce carbon dioxide levels in some patients just by changing the VQ matching, and you know, so they can ventilate better. It also, I think, there's a role with sleep state instability. You know, as we often we see this in the lab, we apply CPAP for the first time, you know, maybe in a split night, and there are more transitions from sleep to wakefulness, and this can kind of precipitate the onset of sleep onset centrals, which are actually fairly physiologic unless they're happening over and over and over again. And then of course, that's somewhat disruptive to sleep. So I think those are the main mechanisms that have been described. Of course, some patients, I guess also we have to say, are on medications that can have dual effects. So for example, opioids, we know that we're much more likely to see central apneas in patients who are on chronic opioid therapy, and they're also more likely to experience obstructive events. So we shouldn't be surprised. We relieve the one, we see the other.
So the mechanism is not fully elucidated, but the phenomenon certainly occurs. So let's move to practical things now. Let's consider the scenario of a patient undergoing a split-night polysomnogram. The study confirms OSA, but as soon as CPAP's applied, central apneas start developing despite control of obstructive breathing. Should the patient be placed on CPAP despite this? Should the patient be placed on something like ASV, either empirically or with another sleep study? Now, some years ago, you examined this problem in a very important controlled trial, and I think the results are still very relevant today. So can you tell us the results of that study and how it has helped you to resolve the practical conundrum of what do we do about patients like the one I've just described?
Yeah, thanks so much, Michael. That has been a fun expedition to try to sort all this out. And, you know, my interest in the whole disorder really started because I observed many patients where it seemed like those residual CSAs, central sleep apnea, seemed to be causing a lot of trouble. And so we designed that study to try to determine what is the answer to this question. Do they really resolve, as many said that they would, or do they persist? And, you know, what's the answer? And so I love these kind of controversies because you can do the research and perhaps get an answer. So we did organize a multi-center study. We randomized patients with treatment emergent central sleep apnea to receive CPAP only, and then the others to receive ASV only. And then we followed them each, or all of those patients, for about 3 months. And what we found was if we considered resolution to mean that their AHI was less than 5 at that 3-month mark, then only a third of the patients actually completely resolved their central sleep apnea. If we instead were a little bit more generous and said, okay, what if an AHI less than 10 is good enough? Well, then 2/3 of the patients came down that low over time. So we really didn't power the study to determine if it made a difference in symptoms. And in the study itself, we didn't see a big difference in symptoms between the two. But I think this study did change my approach, and that's what you were asking. I think prior to that, because ASV was so effective for these patients, I probably put almost everybody on an ASV. I now had before me some evidence that some patients might do okay with CPAP. So now I'm a bit more selective, and I take several factors into account. The first one is, well, how much residual CSA was there, and how much was it interrupting their sleep? If the residual apnea-hypopnea index is relatively low, you know, let's say 10-ish or so, and there aren't many interruptions to their sleep and they did well, then I'd likely favor trying CPAP alone and follow up and see how they do. I also try to pay attention as I'm observing the polysomnogram to what I think the mechanism of the central apneas are. We mentioned earlier that there might be a role for many arousals or sleep state transitions. If many of the central apneas that I'm seeing are post-arousal, I think there's reason to keep in mind that that might be less of an issue as they acclimate to CPAP therapy. And so I might, again, you know, give CPAP a trial there. And I think the third thing is, what's my capacity to ensure follow-up? Because we know, again, that, you know, anywhere from one-third to two-thirds of the patients don't resolve. And so if I feel very comfortable that I have a good relationship with the patient, that we'll have follow-up, that they know they can reach out to me if they're not succeeding with their therapy before a planned follow-up at, you know, 1 to 2 months, then I'll feel more comfortable trying CPAP. But if any of those things don't really make sense to me, we do have to acknowledge that some of the other studies that we did here at Mayo, looking at this patient population, that people who have these persistent central apneas on CPAP, they don't do as well. They have more complaints. They have more chance to drop out. They're not as compliant. So, you know, I think there's room for trying the CPAP. I do that more often now than I did before that study. But I think the critical thing is the follow-up and making sure that the patients have access to you if they're struggling, because we do have better ways to treat those patients.
Very, very helpful. Now, of course, today, the majority of such patients are not getting polysomnograms. They're getting home sleep apnea tests. So let's consider the scenario of a patient who has a home sleep apnea test of whatever type, confirms moderately severe OSA, straightforward. You place the patient on auto-titrating CPAP, say between 5 and 15 centimeters water pressure, and you do, in fact, have follow-up. So the patient returns a month or two later, good adherence to treatment, but the download shows a residual AHI of 16 per hour, and 13 per hour seem to be central apneas according to the download from the system. What do we do?
Right. I have my opinion about this, but maybe informed somewhat. So first of all, I think the important thing that you mentioned is a scenario that's very common, and maybe we're seeing them back at 1 month. And I think, although we haven't published these data, if they haven't resolved at 1 month, they're not very likely to resolve at 3 months. So if we're going to do something, we should probably decide to do it now rather than waiting another 3 months to pray and hope that it's going to resolve. They've usually declared themselves by that. So in my practice, if they're still having symptoms, if they're struggling, even though they might be meeting the criteria, then I think we ought to have a discussion with them about what might be done to correct the treatment emergent central sleep apnea. In this case, you know, it might be worth a trial of changing the patient to a best single CPAP pressure. That's another thing that we can try, because there are reports and studies that show that auto titrating CPAP, again, might just lead to a few more arousals. It might predispose to a bit more of the treatment emergent central sleep apnea. And one other contributing factor, you know, oftentimes a vendor or a patient or someone will put the patient on expiratory pressure relief as a comfort move. And we know that that can function almost like a BiPAP S and can actually augment central apneas in patients that are predisposed in this way. So turning that off, if the patient can allow it and tolerate it, is another thing you might try. But if these kind of things aren't helping, then I think it's time to introduce an ASV trial.
And what about the patient, same thing, comes back and says, oh, I'm so much better, doctor. I'm not sleepy anymore. Thank you. And you look at the download, and there it is, 16 central apneas.
Yeah. Here we need a lot more data. I don't have a brilliant answer for you, because we as you probably know, and our listeners probably know, there are epidemiological data that certainly show that patients with different disorders, you know, whether it be diastolic heart failure or, systolic heart failure, who have central sleep apnea, they have a worse prognosis, but we don't yet have data that's conclusive that shows that reducing that central apnea index in someone who is not symptomatic is going to make them live longer or improve their cardiovascular outcomes. So those are judgment calls on those patients that I don't have good guidance for.
Good. Thank you. Well, that's certainly very helpful to me, and I'm sure to our listeners. Do you have some final messages to leave with our listeners regarding this?
Well, yes. So, I mean, first of all, I would say that treatment emergent central sleep apnea certainly is problematic for many patients. I think it is responsible for treatment failures in many patients where only the obstructive component's been addressed and they really have quite a bit of underlying central sleep apnea. I believe that the majority of patients have an underlying mechanism that they actually have some inherent problem with the respiratory control system. And if it doesn't correct within that first month, then, you know, I think it's time to think about what to do for them. So attentive observation is critical, you know, not only to the readings on initial polysomnography, but to the downloads from PAP therapy as follows. And I think then, you know, thinking about the principles we've talked about today may help guide therapy and hopefully bring more patients to successful treatment.
Tim, thank you so much. That's been very helpful, and I hope our listeners have enjoyed it. Thank you for being with us with us today.
Thank you so much, Mike.
We hope you enjoyed this podcast. If so, please tune in again through wherever you receive your podcasts as we discuss further topics in sleep medicine and sleep health. Thank you.